Can you hear me back there? I'll speak up a little bit more. My name is Lauren Behrensfather. I'm the director of the Holocaust Center of Pittsburgh, and I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight on a chilly, snowy, icy night, although as many people have commented, much better than last night. The Holocaust Center of Pittsburgh regularly hosts field trips and introduces students to Holocaust survivors, but rarely do we give the same opportunity to the public. We created a survivor lecture series to fill that gap so that anyone who wanted to could hear from a Holocaust survivor. What an incredible experience that we can share with you. Recently, we've also revived our program for relatives and descendants of Holocaust survivors, which we call our Generations Group. It was a natural thing for us to merge these two ideas. Tonight's program is the second in the Generations Lecture Series. I would like to thank a number of people from Tree of Life Congregation for hosting us tonight. Joel Goldstein, Alex Speck, Rabbi Jeffrey Myers, the facility staff at Tree of Life, especially Augie, who has been very helpful. So Stacy Scivio, who's here from the Jewish Federation to help us out tonight. Judah Samet, who was one of our speakers. I would like to thank Judah for doing this, and his sister Miriam Cohen for being here. Both of them overcoming the evil villain of winter, the flu. I would like to thank the staff and leadership of the Holocaust Center of Pittsburgh, always very supportive of us. Tonight's program, in addition to Judah and Miriam, includes Shannon Phillips Shyrock, who has been working with the Holocaust Center of Pittsburgh and working closely with the Generations Group and with Judah as he tells his story in schools all over the region. We're going to hear from everyone on the stage, and then at the end of the program, there will be a chance to ask questions. We have a microphone for that that is a stationary microphone between the two rows of seats. You can see it right there. My understanding is that we cannot move that microphone and that also we're not supposed to touch it. So you may have to contort a little bit to get your mouth where it needs to be to talk into the microphone. But if people who have questions would line up behind the microphone at the end of the program, then we'll be able to do that. So thank you again for being here. It is my honor now to turn the microphone over. I believe, Miriam, you're going first. Thank you, Miriam.
What is it like to grow up in a home with parents and four siblings who are Holocaust survivors? My name is Miriam Cohen, and my mother survived Bergen-Belsen with four children, both of her parents and her only brother. My father lost his wife and three children and most of his siblings during the Holocaust. He met my mother in Israel, they married, and he adopted her four children. Before I go into my story, I'd like to give you some background on the life of my parents before the Holocaust. My mom was born Hannah Rachel Marmolstein and lived a life of privilege in Hungary until the war began. My mom was a dynamo. Although she stood under 5 feet tall, Judah will tell you that she was 10 feet tall. She was very independent, confident, and smart with a great sense of humor. From a young age, she helped my grandfather in the family business, and at the age of 16 was his bill collector. She had always wanted to be a doctor. However, her father would not hear of it. Her family was very orthodox, and religious girls did not go into such professions. So instead, she married Yekutiel Samet and started a sweater factory with him in Debrecen, Hungary. Together, they had three sons and a daughter. They had a happy, full life when Eichmann marched into Debrecen with the Gestapo in 1944. My brother Judah will address how they ended up in Berlin-Belsen, their liberation, and his father's death after the war. My father, Moshe Shimon Schwartz, was born in a small town in Hungary called Levelek. He was one of many children and had to quit school at a young age to help support the family. Although he did not speak much about it, his father was tough, his mom was ill, and life was hard. My father married, he became a baker and started his own bakery business and had two sons and two daughters. When the Germans came to my father's hometown, my father made a financial arrangement with a neighbor to hide his wife and kids. My father was taken almost immediately to a concentration camp, and because of his culinary skills, he worked the mess hall of the German high officers. His wife and three kids were turned in immediately by the neighbor to the Gestapo and were never heard from again. My father never spoke a word about what he went through in the war or his lost family. Going back to growing up in a family of Holocaust survivors, my parents met in Israel. My father fell in love with my mother and wanted to get married. My mother did not want to marry anyone, let alone my father, who was very handsome, but not as educated the way her first husband was. My dad was not giving up and pursued her relentlessly until she gave in. My mother, wanting my father to have children of his own, had my brother Itzik, and 6 years later had me when she was 43. That in itself was a struggle. Since she was 43 years old, her doctors wanted her to abort, but she would have none of that. She told everyone that she will have a baby girl with blue eyes, and she ran away to Jerusalem and stayed with her parents where she knew that an abortion would not take place. I grew up in a home where there was a picture over my parents' bed of a woman and three children. I knew from a very young age that I was not allowed to ask any questions. I regret that as an adult, I never tried to approach my father. My father never spoke about his first family. That was the only picture I've seen of them until many years later when I found a picture of his wife and three children with my father in it that was damaged. My husband restored it, and we have it in our living room. Since then, several of my nephews and other family members have requested a copy. My father never opened up about his experiences and what he went through during the war. All I know was that my father was a very broken man, a very anxious and angry one, but also loving and devoted to his family. My mother was a very strong woman, but when I was two, my brother Yaakov, who survived the Holocaust, died in a war in Israel in 1956 Sinai campaign. My mother was never the same after that. She worked, but did very little else. After reading articles about Holocaust victims having PTSD symptoms, I realized that my mother was having some of those symptoms herself. She withdrew from life, relationships, and most of her activities. My father worked all night as a baker and took on the responsibility of cooking and baking for the family. The children took on the role of cleaning and laundry. My sister Henya, who's 14 years older than I, took on the role of primary caregiver for me. When I grew up, we did household chores together. She was also my teacher in first and second grade. We were very close. My home life became difficult after Yaakov's death. My father worked hard during the night and then came home to many other responsibilities that were clearly way too much for him to handle. He was a very heavy smoker who did not smoke on the Sabbath. Because we kept an Orthodox home, he was anxious and angry, especially on Shabbat. The environment at home was scary. My father was physically and verbally abusive. My brother Itzik caught the brunt of his anger. My father was physically and verbally abusive to him. With my older siblings out of the house, there was no one there to protect him. I did my best by never telling on him, but I was too young, scared, and powerless to do anything else. My mom could have controlled my father, and the only thing that I could think of is that she was too depressed to do anything. I know my brother is still very angry at them, even all these years after their death. I was very independent from a very young age and very devoted to my parents. I was more of a caregiver to them than they were to me. I understood why my parents could not be there for me, as perhaps some of my friends' parents were there for them. When I was 7 years old, we were living in a farm in Israel. My brother Judah and my sister Henya moved to Canada and then the States when Judah met his wife to be from Pittsburgh. When I was 8, my mother went to the States to attend the wedding and decided that life was simpler with more opportunities than in Israel. So she stayed with my sister Henya in New York and worked on a green card to bring my father, Itzik, and I to New York. I did not see or speak to my mom again until I was 10. In the meantime, my father sold the farm and we moved into a studio apartment in Jerusalem with my oldest brother Moshe, who was working on his doctorate in Jewish history at the Hebrew University. My life changed drastically. I was 8 years old, living in a big city, new school, new tiny apartment with very little supervision. I also had the responsibility of all the chores in the house, except for cooking, since I was the only girl. I did not get help and managed well. My father never abused me physically. His worst punishment for me was the silent treatment. And believe me, sometimes that was worse. I remember one incident in particular during summer vacation. A friend asked me to go to the movies with her. I told her that I could not go until my chores were done. She, however, talked me into going. When I came home, the apartment was spotless, and my father did not speak to me for 3 days. Some of his punishments were not so bad. When I complained that I did not like eating the same thing day in and day out, my father arranged for me to eat lunch in a restaurant daily. I had steak and French fries and loved that punishment. My father and I did pretty well most of the time. I understood that he had nothing more to give me. How do you start a new life, a new family, without money or home in a new land after you just went through the most unthinkable, devastating, and brutal life in a concentration camp, losing your loved ones and with the threat of death daily? When my parents married, they started from scratch. My dad had tried several businesses in Israel and in the States, but was not very successful. Both my parents worked real long and difficult hours. Despite all the hardship, My parents made sure that we had a comfortable home, clothing, and plenty of good food, as well as education to give us a good start in life. As I grew older, my father quit smoking. He mellowed with age and seemed more content with his life. After high school, I moved back to Israel, and my parents followed me. They lived the rest of their life in Israel, which made my father very happy. He spent his last years going to synagogue daily and studying Torah, which he did not get a chance to do in the past. I always wonder if I would be a different person, professional, daughter, wife, mother, if our circumstances were different. I do believe that I do not take anything for granted and appreciate my freedom, my family, my husband, my kids, my grandchildren, and my friends because of my background.
Thank you very much, Miriam. Now Judah is going to tell his story, and I have a few questions that will guide his story. So, Judah, do you want to say anything before we get started?
Yeah, just kiss my sister.
So, Judah, can you tell me about your life before the Holocaust?
I went to Heidel. It's a Jewish school. It was in the synagogue across, directly across from our home. And my parents were the major donors to that synagogue. And at the age of 6 and 2 months old, they came for us. And my 14 months in hell of the Nazis, 10 and a half months of it in Bergen-Belsen, which turned out to be one of the worst of the worst. And that's the answer I can give you, what happened, you know, before the Holocaust.
So, I know that your family had a successful sweater business before the war, you had a very comfortable life, and you were very devoted in your faith. And can you tell me about when the Nazis invaded your town?
It was noontime. We were having lunch. The Nazis knew that everybody, every Jew, is going to be home for lunch, because lunch was the major meal of the day. In the evening, we usually had a little cheese, some cookies, or something like that. So they knew every Jew is going to be home, and that's when they came for us. And they, I remember, actually, their steps moving up the street. We expected them, but then we heard those steps. And of course, we were all scared the hell out of. And they stopped right in front of our house because we were in the middle of the street. And they gave us 15 minutes to be out. Take with us only a little suitcase with some change and our valuables. Don't take anything else. We are taking you to a better place. And of course, we all assembled outside. And as soon as we were all outside, they started to march us. They marched us to the railroad station, where trains would come for us. And there were about 7,000 living in Debrecen. That was the city where I came from, where I was born. It's about the second or third largest city in Hungary. About 175,000 people. And among the 7,000 people, you had old people, you had little children, you had sick people. They didn't care. They were shoving us, herring us. If you couldn't move fast enough, you got beaten up. And if you fell down, you couldn't get up, You were finished. What bothered me, thinking back, more than anything else, they were moving us through the main streets of Debrecen. Some of those people walking to and fro on the sidewalks knew us. They may have been neighbors. Maybe they worked for my parents. My parents had two knitting factories. But we were ghosts. They didn't see us. They didn't even look at us. And that was the first experience. That was terrible. After walking for several hours, we finally arrived at the railroad. And at the railroad, my mother, who was an activist, she took on herself to cook for the masses. By the way, by then there were 13,000, because Jews were brought in also from the small towns around Debrecen. So there were about 13,000. They gave her four bathtubs, or two bathtubs. She made four bathtubs of soup a day. She wasn't by herself. She had a group of women helping her. But she was the master. Or she was the Ganzenmacher. She was the doer. You know, my mother had three qualities. First of all, she was a beautiful woman to look at. This picture shows her after birth, so she's a little puffed. But if you look outside, you'll see a picture of her when she was 16 years old. And also, you'll see a picture of us without my father. He died already. And that was after the war. So, first quality was, even though she was short 4'10", but she was well built. What do you call it? Hourglass room? But secondly, more importantly, she was smart out of the box. She was a brilliant, brilliant woman. And the third, and it's going to come later on a little bit, she had guts. She was fearless, something unfortunately I inherited from her. But she was a fearless woman. And the best quality she had, she spoke fluent German. She could read and write, very high German. And how does the daughter of a Hasid learn to speak German? My grandfather suffered a great deal in the synagogue. How dare you educate a woman? Women have two places. One is in the bedroom, and the other one is in the kitchen. Women are not supposed to be educated. But she and my mom and my grandmother ganged up on him, and she went to the gymnasium. There was only one other Jewish girl in the gymnasium, and they suffered tremendous anti-Semitism there. But words never hurt my mother. She was broad-shouldered. And straight over her shoulder, say, don't ever mind what people tell you. Mind what people are doing to you. So she went to the gymnasium. Anybody who's familiar with gymnasiums in Europe knows that they're the equivalent of maybe 2-3 years of college. Mm-hmm. Very, very high education. So that's how she became the interpreter. And as an interpreter, she saved not just that. We didn't get any preference from the Germans at all. She saved hundreds, maybe thousands of people who were sick already from starvation on the train to Auschwitz.
Okay, Judah. Now, after your family was rounded up and you were taken out of your hometown, you were on a train to Auschwitz, and I know that your family was very fortunate because the Czech partisans bombed the railroad tracks, and so you weren't able to go to Auschwitz, because if you would have went to Auschwitz, definitely as a child, you wouldn't be here. Can you describe how, at the labor camp that you ended up in Austria, how your mother helped your family to survive?
Well, first I want to say something about the train. First train arrived, and my Anton had six children. got on the train. My mother begged me not to go. She said, you know where we are going? We are going to Auschwitz. But she couldn't stand the crying from her six little children. They were hungry. What do little children do when they are hungry? They cry. She had another son, the older one, and the father were taken immediately to a labor camp because he was 16 years old. Once you are 16, you're an adult, and you go and work for them. So anyhow, unfortunately, she got on the train, and we never saw them again. When I was in Brooklyn, I did meet my cousin. He was half crazy. I wanted to see his father. He said, you don't want to see my father. He's completely crazy. You lose a wife and six children, obviously, you cannot remain normal. So anyhow, we were on the platform to enter the cattle cars that were going to take us to Auschwitz. My mother noticed, and she was standing next to the commandant, and right next to him was a Gestapo sergeant. She noticed that they were putting two buckets in each car. One bucket was filled with water. It was a small bucket, maybe 3-4 gallons or something like that. And the other one was for toilet purposes. There was no such thing as modesty. You know, when you are hungry for 2-3 months, who cares about what you look like? So there was no modesty at all. My mother committed a cardinal crime. He addressed the commandant. My mother never raised her voice on anybody, including us. She spoke very quietly, but when you looked into her eyes, you knew that you did something wrong, and you didn't want to do anything wrong to disappoint my mother. So anyhow, she addressed the commandant, and she said, we know where we are going, but what will the people on the way there say about the Germans? What happened to the German people who were the flower of the Western world? They were the best educated. They were the best in any human endeavor. 1933, they won 50% of all the Nobel Prizes. 37.5% of that was won by Jews. I imagine that this crowd, if you ask, can you tell me one Jew that won a Nobel Prize? Probably everybody would say Albert Einstein. Well, he was going to get another one for chemistry. He says, one is enough, give it to somebody else. So the Gestapo unholstered his pistol, put it to my mother's head, ready to shoot. The commandant didn't even look at him, because it was a different class. He says, you dunkaf, you idiot, can't you see if you kill her? We have nobody to talk to. Now, what was my mother's calculation? She figured, if you make it to Auschwitz, you're going to die anyhow. Maybe something is going to happen. And evidently something happened. The Czech partisans blew up the railways, and they took us back to Austria, where we were for about 3-4 months. And you ask me about it. That was the labor camp. They worked, our parents, 12 hours a day. We were little kids. And we were on, actually, starvation diet. So what my mother used to do, after 12 hours of work, she would go out to this local farm nearby and huntle with a farmer, with a wife of the farmers. They all had babies. And my mother said, I'm going to knit for them clothes. Just get me a needle and get me some yarn. And for that, and she knit clothes like you would see in Saks Fifth Avenue. She was very, very talented. She's the one who taught my father how to knit and how to run a factory. So for that, she got a little bread, a little butter, and a little milk, a few little things, not too much. And she would bring it to us. One day, she didn't come home. And we figured something must have happened. After 2 days, she didn't come home. We got real scared, because she was the heart and soul of the family. She kept the whole family together. And sure enough, a few days later, she came back. And we asked her, what happened? She said, well, somebody squealed, and the squad of German soldiers, the young officer, who was very, very handsome, came. They put her in jail. She shared the room with a German girl, with an Austrian girl, an Austrian beauty. She was between 18 and 20. And what was her crime? Hitler gave direct orders to all beautiful girls between 18 and 25 to entertain German soldiers coming home for furlough. Punishment, death. She ended up, they hung her, they killed her. How my mother survived, we never asked her. I think maybe it has something to do with a very handsome German officer. But we never asked her. It was a presumption. Because my mother would do anything to save us. Anything at all. And evidently, she did something to save us.
Okay, Judith, so after you were in the labor camp in Austria, then your family was sent on another train and you ended up in Bergen-Belsen. And this was one of the worst camps, definitely, in all of the concentration camp system. So let's talk a little bit about how your life was in Bergen-Belsen. Can you tell me about how you and another boy, how you would try to find food, and what the Nazi officers called you in Bergen-Belsen?
Well, to the officers were kleine jüdische Schweinehunde, little Jewish pig dogs. That's what they called us. But we always followed them coming out of their mess hall, and their mess hall was like a five-star restaurant. They had everything they wanted. There was another mess hall for soldiers and guards. They also got decent food, but not as good. And then the third one was us. Potatoes, a slice of bread, and a little potato soup that was basically water with some color to it. And that was our fare every day. In fact, we got a rock-hard black bread the size of a grapefruit. And many of the inmates were so hungry that they ate it. They died. My mother broke it down to olive sizes. And she fed us maybe 4, 5, 6 times a day. She gave us an olive size, and then she gave us a teaspoon from the soup. And I believe that was one of the main reasons that we survived. There was another thing that helped us survive, is the camp was inundated with lice. I mean, they were crawling all over the place. My mother reasoned with us that if we eat the lice, we are only taking back what the lice took from us. It was blood. Lice are blood suckers, and blood is protein. So I always say, between that bread and the soup and the lice and what we found on the floor, that was German officers threw down, I guess was enough to keep us alive. And my friend and I don't remember his name, I have a picture of him in my mind. We were always out hunting for food, but there was nothing. If there were any animals, they were eaten maybe a few years before we got there. Because our story started about 14, 15 months before the end of the war, which was very, very bad for us in a way, because by the time they came to us, what happened is Hungary was allied with the Nazis. But then Miklos Horthy, who was a regent, like prime minister, when he could hear the footsteps of the Russians, he broke that alliance, and the Germans immediately invaded Hungary. And with them came Eichmann. And Eichmann brought with him 21 SS officers. He used to say that that my job in Hungary is so easy because the Hungarians are more interested in killing Jews than even the Germans. These were the Hungarians. You know, Jews lived in Hungary for 1700 years. They came with Attila the Hun. They were there before most of those Hungarians that hated us. And in fact, one of the reasons that my father went to the Dutch consulate and get us passports to come to America is because on the way home from work one night, he was attacked by a gang. One of the gang members was a worker of his. And he figured, if one of my workers is willing to kill me, it's time to leave. Unemployment in Hungary was terrific. So if you had a job, especially my father was a very benevolent employer. He was very, very good to his workers. We had workers at home too. We had two or three women working for us, one in the kitchen, and so forth. My mother came from a very entrepreneurial family. In fact, her grandfather was a judge, and he was an agent. I don't know if you know what an agent is. He was an agent for an aristocrat. I think must have been a prince. He ran his lands for him. He rented out the land today to the farmers and collected. The aristocrat was very rarely at home. He used to be somewhere in Europe, hobnobbing with the royalty of Europe. But he would come home every so often, maybe every 2 years or 3 years, and he would settle with my great grandfather, whose name was Moshe Blum or Morris Blum. And what did he give him? He didn't give him money. He gave him a piece of land. Over the years, my great grandfather accumulated a huge piece of land himself, and he rented it to the farmers. Some of it he kept, and he built a ranch where he was raising Arabian horses for the Hungarian officers' corps. Hungarians like to dress up, especially if you were in the officer corps, you had to be high-born. You couldn't come from the bottom and become an officer. You have to be very high-born. So they all like to dress up, sit on a beautiful Arabian horse, and what my great-grandfather did, he was also very benevolent. He built a free hotel, and he supported the church in town.
Okay, Judah, thank you very much. It was very interesting to hear about Bergen-Belsen and also about your family and the life that they led in Hungary. They were obviously very prosperous and did very, very well before the war. Okay, so getting back to Bergen-Belsen, can you tell me about the death train that your mother decided to put you on from Bergen-Belsen? Why she decided to do that and what the conditions were like on the train?
I was on three death trains. The first one was to Auschwitz. Miraculously, we didn't make it. The second was to Bergen-Belsen. We were supposed to die in Bergen-Belsen. There were 60,000 people who actually died in Bergen-Belsen. Some of them, in fact, more than just some, actually committed suicide. They would lay down, figuring that tomorrow is going to be the same, following tomorrow is going to be the same, so what's the use getting up? So they just lay down and they died. And this, my little friend and I, we were walking it. Out of respect, we tried to go around them, but after a while, we came with ourselves, so we just walked over them. And we could actually hear the bones cracking. But it didn't mean anything to us. That did not mean at the age of seven, I turned seven in Bergen-Belsen. At the age of seven, I've seen more death than life. And the life I saw were just about ready to die. So, what was it? was the interpreter, but he didn't give us any privilege at all. We didn't get any more food than anybody else, except that the Judenrat, that was the Jewish committee, was in charge of keeping the camp clean, and it needed work all the time, because the two major killers in Bergen-Belsen was typhoid and dysentery. Nobody made it in time to the bathroom. So the whole camp was going to be bathroom. So the Judenrat assigned people. The Germans knew how to pick it. They were very cruel themselves, even though they were Jews. But there was some mitigation to their behavior, because the Nazis watched them. If they were not cruel enough, they would shoot them. And being the interpreter, that's what saved my wife, my mother. Because, and she got into trouble with the head of the Jewish committee. She threatened them after the war, she's going to see to it that he hangs, because he kept the best part of the suit and divided among his friends, and some of it he sold. So anyhow, he couldn't do anything, because if the commandant came and he didn't see the interpreter, he asked him, where's the interpreter? And he started to him and hung. He shot him on the spot, because there were plenty waiting. Yeah. So anyhow, I was coming close to the end of the war, and the Germans came, and they said that we have a train waiting here. We need about only 750 of you to get on the train. My mother threw us on the train, and I was at that point. But we didn't ask any questions, because we knew that my mother has our back, and she knows what she is doing. In fact, growing up, never for one second did I feel that my mother did not love us. She loved us all the time. And when we disappointed her, I remember in Hungary, my father was chasing my brother Jakob around the dining room table. My mother happened to be home, because she was on the road selling the wares of the factory. She just came out of the kitchen, and she said, Tibi, that was his Hungarian name. My Hungarian name was Imre. And the big one, Moshe, was Polly, and my sister was Mari. So he came, brought his head, came straight to her, very light. Now, what did you do? You see, our biggest fear of my mother was to disappoint her. She loved us so much. How could we disappoint her? I know my sister had already a little different experience. After my brother Yaakov got killed in Rafiah, southern Gaza, she changed. I remember when an officer took me out of class, I was teaching in Beersheba, and people, the soldiers were coming back from the Sinai, singing and dancing, and I knew I had no reason to sing or dance. As soon as I got home, my mother was sitting already on a long chair, and when she saw me, she said, at least he did not die in Bergen-Belsen. He died for the state of Israel. So anyhow, many years later, I used to go visit her every year, at least once, or bring her here for a couple months, and she used to stay with Miriam. She wanted to stay with her daughter. And I asked her, Emma, why did you put us on the train? And she said, I had two choices. One was a sure thing, and one was maybe. And I chose the maybe. The sure thing was that if we stayed in Bergen-Belsen another day or two, we would be all dead, because they stopped feeding us for the last week or two. The Germans ran away. The infrastructure completely collapsed. So that's why they put us. And evidently, her instincts were good again. That was my mother. She was the businesswoman. She was the head of the family. Although my father was an Ilui in the yeshiva. And I heard it from my wife's uncle, who shared a room with him in Hungary. They went to yeshiva together, and he told me that your father was the Ilui. And that's how he got to marry my mother. The Ilui always got to marry the rich girl in town. So they made a very nice couple. My father was a tremendous Talmudic scholar, and he also played a green mean chess game. And they,
Can you tell me about the conditions on the death train and how you were rescued from the train?
Yeah, on the train, again, there were so many people on the train, but we were laying one on top of the other. There was another reason for it. This way you kept them all before. Because cattle cars, the planes don't touch each other, so the cold wind blows straight through. And the only reason we didn't suffer the cold so much is because we were hungry. When you are hungry, when your stomach is empty, nothing else bothers you. I always tell the kids, if a little doggy bit on my toe, I wouldn't even feel it. I was kind of a line between the brain and the stomach. That's all that worked. So anyhow, there was an old, I don't know if it was old, to me he looked old, I was 7 years old. And he maybe was 25, maybe 30, but he had a stubble, and he looked like a very old man to me. The train would stop every 3-4 days, unload the dead. And they burned them, they buried them, and the train continued. One day, I realized that the old man next to me was dead. He didn't move. Of course, there was no odor or anything like that. We found out later that the odor was so bad when we were rescued that they took us immediately to the showers, the Americans, and they lost us because it was so bad. What happened is, if you couldn't make it to the bathroom, and you had to go to the bathroom, what do? You let it down your pants. It was like that for weeks, as the train was going from place to place, looking for a place where they could finish us off. So that day, the train stopped, and they took that old man down. And that angered me a great deal, because he was my pillow, and he was my blanket. And now I was unprotected. And we also noticed that the guards on the top of the cars, Germans, were changing. At first they were regular military, and they had anti-aircraft machine guns, because American airplanes were surrounding us and other trains, trying to figure out if the train was carrying ammunition, or German soldiers, or inmates like us. So luckily, they figured out right about us. You heard the planes, but the planes didn't bomb us. And eventually, the soldiers were replaced, because most of them were killed on the Russian front. I think like 2 million German soldiers were killed fighting the Soviet Union, and another 1 million fighting the Americans, and the Canadians, and the English. All of a sudden we saw teenagers on the cars. Who were the teenagers? They were called Hitlerjugend. Those were the favorite of Hitler. They were the most dedicated to Hitler, and they would kill just like the adults. Then all of a sudden, they were not there either. And they opened the doors. My father was studying English already, you know, getting ready to go to America, so he had to know English. So anyhow, we were in the middle of a forest. There was a great rumble. And we thought, oh, this is the spot where they're going to finish us off. Sure enough, a tank came rumbling out of the forest. The turret of the tank was not aimed at the train. That was the first clue. And the second clue, when the turret opened, the soldier jumped up. His uniform was different. So my father yelled, "Americans." And sure enough, we all came out of the train. And we all surrounded the tank. I think the tank was filled with candy. And he was handing out candy. Not too much, just a little bit. And people asked him, "Where are you from?" He said, "I'm from Brooklyn." "Or is there a Jew in New York who doesn't have somebody in Brooklyn?" So everybody asked me, "Do you know my aunt?" He was supposed to know everybody, and he knew everybody. So anyhow, a group of dancers and singing, as much energy as we had, and then they packed us back on the train and took us to Hillersleben. Hillersleben was a big city on the Rhine River. It was very broad, very big, and there was a big bridge, but the bridge was bombed out. And we figured, this is where they were going to finish us. They closed the doors, there was no way out, and they were going to push the whole train into the Rhine River. But thank God the Americans got there first. But I gotta tell you that Bergen-Belsen was not freed by the Americans. It was freed by the English, by the British. What happened is, there were some German soldiers who did not realize that the war was over. They kept fighting. So they were fighting the British very close to Bergen-Belsen. And all of a sudden, they saw this man with a white coat, looked like a doctor, coming and yelling, "Medicine, medicine, medicine." They didn't know what to do, but eventually they understood. And when they came to the gate of Bergen-Belsen, it was like the gate of hell itself. There were 13,000 corpses strewn all over the camp. You couldn't walk without walking on somebody. And another 30 to 50,000 who had maybe 1 to 2 days life in them. They would all die. It took a long time for the Allies to figure out how to feed the survivors because they didn't have stomachs. Finally, they came out, I think from Australia, they came out with some kind of a baby formula, and they were feeding us half a spoon at a time, very low, until we were built up a little bit. And then we got back on the train, and by the way, now I'm going to go back to Bergen-Belsen again. So anyhow, I understand that Eisner came, and when he saw what's going on, he said, "Kill them all." You know, he was so mad. And they so anyhow, there were some excuse me. In London. He said, "If all heavens were paper, all the trees in the entire universe were pens, and all the oceans and the rivers and lakes were ink, would not be enough to describe what I have seen in Bergen-Belsen. I happened to watch 3 Eyes on public TV, the trial of the 21 leaders of the Nazi Party. They wanted to show that the gravity of the German people, so they showed a movie about Bergen-Belsen. They dug a big hole. At first, they tried to bury him respectfully with Kaddish and so forth. But eventually they gave up. There were so many, they dug a huge hole and they brought a huge bulldozer and and they shoved all the bodies right into it. And then, of course, they said, cut the shoulder. But that was very embarrassing. When the people ask me, how do you compare it to Auschwitz? I said, well, in Auschwitz, you suffered for about, first of all, you were scared to death because you knew where you're going. But once you arrived in Auschwitz, and after the selection, women, children, and the elderly were taken immediately to guest chambers. And within 40, 50 minutes, you were coming out of the smokestacks. In Bergen-Belsen, you suffered until you died, and sometimes it could take months and months.
Okay, so we're going to open it up to questions now. Miriam, would you like to have the first question? Or do you want to open it? Okay, great. Does anyone?
Yeah, I'm going to address the other.
Okay, go ahead. This question is about guilt. I lost 91 people in my family. We know who killed them. And all my uncles in America fought in World War II. I was born after the Holocaust was over and after the World War II was over, 1946. My father was deemed a valuable scientist, and he was walked to work every day, so he didn't fight. I think he had everlasting guilt because of that. And I was raised with pictures of all the people we lost on the walls, and the survivors were paraplegic. We got them and took care of them until they died. So it was, I grew up in a life of privilege. There was nothing said to me, but I had overwhelming guilt. It was just like this free-floating guilt that had to do with maybe not having suffered or having to live with the aftermath. I don't know where it came from, but as a child, I would say I had a nightmare of persecution for about 5 years of just being playing happily and suddenly being snatched by a Nazi. And I never told people that except for my parents, and they didn't really respond to it. About 10 years ago, my cousin, who's an astrophysicist, was invited to Cambridge to work in Cambridge, and then he was lecturing in Poland, and he actually went to see the man who killed us all. My family. He's still living. He's in his 90s, and he's living on his own property and part of my family's property in Austria, that now is Poland. And when my cousin went, he told the rest of us, and suddenly this whole topic of guilt came about. None of us knew that the other people were suffering from it, that the cousins were suffering from it. I wonder if you had a similar experience and how you handled it. Yes.
Yeah. I want to say something about Miriam's father, my stepfather. We were concerned about him. We even thought that he may have been a part of the Jewish committee. But we never asked him, he never spoke. One day in Jerusalem, my mother and my stepfather went to see my grandfather, my grandparents. And they were walking up the street on King George Street, and they passed this restaurant that was very boisterous. Seemed like there was either bar mitzvah or a wedding, something going on in that restaurant. And there were a few men at the door talking very loud, as you do after a few beers or maybe one or something like that. So as they passed, one of them said, "Maury Schwartz." He turned around, he didn't recognize him. So he kept going. Then again, a little louder, "Maury said to him, "These people seem to know you. Aren't you anxious to know how they know you?" So he went over in a very respectful way. He said, "Gentlemen, I don't know who you are, but you seem to know why." And he said, "Oh yeah, we know who you are." And he said, "How do you know me?" He said, "Because of you, we are here. You saved our life." "How did you do it?" "You remember, he was put in the mess hall of the officers in a concentration camp. And they would send him every day on a truck, in the back of a truck, with a German soldier and a German driver. And he would go to the market and buy the best of everything. Money was no object. And then on the way home, as he was passing the fence, and the fence was electrified, but since people threw themselves on the electric fence, committing suicide, they always had a dozen or so inmates fixing the fence. And as he was passing the fence, he would throw down a bread. He would throw down a piece of cheese. He would throw down some fruit. He threw down enough to sustain him, making sure that the inspector at the kitchen will not notice that stuff is missing. So that's when I talk to kids, I'll tell them, don't look at the bottle, look at what's in it. He had a golden heart. Unfortunately, you lose a wife and three children. It has a tremendous effect on you. And I wanted you to know that I always say about my sister Miriam, you know, she's a part of the Hebrew tradition. You know what I said? If my sister was not a Jew, she'd be a nun.
I do want to address what you asked about guilt, but I also want to say something about Judah. You know, he talks about my mom being this savior of the family, and she truly was. But when Judah said he took on her role, he wasn't kidding. I mean, Judah is the kind of person in our family that if you need anything, he would be there and he would give you the shirt off his back. And I don't know if I say it enough, how appreciative I am of that. But he is a very, very special person. As far as your question about guilt, it's actually a very, very good question. I don't think I grew up feeling guilty because I had so many other things to contend with. I didn't have time for really thinking much about what I was going through. And in fact, when generations asked me to speak about what it was like to grow up in a home with Holocaust survivors, it was probably the hardest thing I had to do was put it down on paper. For many reasons. Number one, to admit that my father abused my brother was extremely difficult for me. To know that I couldn't do a whole lot to help him was very difficult for me. Did I feel guilty about it? Yeah, I did. I did at times because my father did not treat me the same way, and I felt guilty about that. I felt guilty when my siblings had difficult times in their lives because I really felt that a lot of it had to do because of what they went through. And I won't even go into that. But that kind of guilt, but not the kind of guilt that I could really do anything about. But I could see what you mean about guilt. I don't know if that helps you. Answers.
Yeah, I just wanted to say something. I told you at the age of 7, I had seen more death than life. When I arrived in Israel, they put us in an orphanage. First, my mother couldn't take care of the four of us. Secondly, the government wanted to separate us to for us to become Israelis as quickly as possible. So they put us in the orphanage. And the orphanage was very tough in the beginning. But I was the toughest there. And all they said, I told them, you fight me, kill me, because I'm going to kill you. I was so full with rage that I was able to do. Eventually, when we learned the Hebrew, then we started to fight the local boys in school. Those who were born second, third generation, they looked down on us because we were orphans, and we looked like orphans. Our clothing was from America, second hand, third hand, and so forth. So we were doing a lot of fighting. That's not what I was going to say. What? Well, we were talking about the, I just want to say something about my brother Yaakov. Yaakov, unfortunately, was killed in the Sinai campaign in 1956. And my brother Moshe, he was fighting up on the Golan Heights. And I was not allowed because two brothers fell already in the military. But when Yaakov got killed, that opened the door for me. And I joined the same unit. Nachal Mitznach. It's young pioneering fighters. We were kind of special forces. We did not have one specific place that we would fight. If war broke out any place, we were the first one to be sent there. And then, eventually, after 1 year, we became also paratroopers. So, we were paratroopers. But Yaakov was an athlete. He was a speed walker. He was a champion. He also liked the girls. And we went to the same high school, Yeshiva High School. And he gave me some of his jobs because he wanted to date. I was making money, but I had nothing to do with it. I remember giving my money to him so he could accomplish his debts. And we had very good relations. He liked to tease me. He knew that I had a temper. Those days I had a big temper. So he used to tease me, and we used to get into a real fight, you know, boxing. Would last about maybe 2 minutes, and then we would grab each other, hug and kiss. We never went mad at each other. There was something about me at the orphanage that if anybody touched my brothers, he had to deal with me. I remember coming into the orphanage and I saw the counselor disciplining my brother Yaakov, was hitting him. I came very quietly from behind and I jumped all the way up to his shoulders and I was paneling with both hands. He tried to get rid of me, he couldn't. And I just kept yelling, if you ever touch my brother, I'll kill you. And it was a thing that I probably could do, too. It was not an exaggeration. Finally, I jumped off, ran home. And when I got home, my grandfather was there. My mother was at work. And my grandfather said, you better go back before your mother comes. And sure enough, my mother came. She saw me. Now, what did you do? And she put me right back.
Are there any other questions?
Yeah. How old were you, Judah, when you came to the States?
How old were you when you came to the States?
I came to the States, I was 25 years old. I actually came, my uncle who was with us in the camps, my mother's brother, that my mother saved his life. She convinced the Nazis that her parents need him because she's busy with the foreigners. And her husband. How the heck she did that is beyond me. So I said, my mother never raised her voice. She took very respectfully, and my uncle was with us. So anyhow, he came to visit his parents and my mother, and he had some men for my sister. So I had a very good job for the government. I ran two small towns for the government, and I had no, actually no desire to go. So my mother said, why don't you take Judah on a little vacation? Sure enough, I went. He lived in Toronto. I didn't like Toronto. It was too cold. Little did I know that Pittsburgh is colder. So I went to Brooklyn. And we do have a large family in Brooklyn. I have a lot of cousins there, and uncles, and aunts, and about two cousins and their father. It was actually the two cousins. They opened the coat factory, and I worked for them. Now, my aunt, that is my uncle's wife, my uncle was my father's brother. They were having their son, who was going to have a bar mitzvah. And they, sure enough, she forced me to come to the bar mitzvah. In the meantime, my wife, who was her father was a cousin of my aunt, her daughter, Barbara, was a school teacher. She was a second grade specialist. And they told her that you are coming with us. She said, I can't leave my kids. She said, don't worry, we already got for you a teacher, a substitute teacher. She said, but also I'm working on my master's at the university. I already talked to the professor. So she had no reason not to go. So that was this bar mitzvah. They took over a Washington Hotel in Bell Harbor. I think it's the only kosher hotel in New York. I mean, black kosher. And they sent my wife and I at the children's table. The oldest child was 5 years old. And here I'm talking to my wife, and she said, I can't hear her, why don't you come sit next to me? What I fell in love with her is her English, because everybody else was a Hungarian. And they were yucking. And here is a woman who spoke beautiful English. Then we went for a walk. In Bell Harbor, you have what you have in Atlantic City, you have a boardwalk. And I looked at her, I said, you have heels. You must be killing me. He says, here it does. Why don't you take your shoes off? And we went back to the hotel. She told me later, she told her father on the way home. They drove. I met the man I'm going to marry. Sure enough, within 3.5 months, you were married. And we have a beautiful girl, very successful.
She's in Pittsburgh.
I don't know anybody who ever was pregnant.
Why did you have a Pittsburgh?
His wife was from Pittsburgh.
Oh, Barbara was from here.
Barbara was from Pittsburgh. She was born actually in the So anyhow, she was a Christian girl, and she was a
Would you mind turning up the microphone? Because some people can't hear you. You turn on the mic.
Well, that's it. You got the babies. I got to mention my daughter, my son, and the two grandkids. You know, my daughter works for Destination Maternity. Any woman here who gave birth to a child probably bought clothes from either maternity or peeing the pot. There is a smile. They have a couple thousand stores, and they have their own design. They have designers and everything, they do themselves. And she's the creative director and she's the vice president. In fact, today, right now, she's Beverly Hills on a fellowship. She has a half a dozen. My son-in-law graduated Cornell in mathematics and theater, but he chose theater. So he created the fund, and it's really moving very nicely now. In fact, they're going to come to Pittsburgh. It's called Jewish Place Project. He put together a group of people of a group of people, and they get about 25 plays a year from different playwrights, and they pick five, and he has a festival in New York. He produces and directs the five. But now he goes around the country, goes to Palo Alto, to San Diego, Boston, all over, and he consults the JCCs how to put on those shows. So next week, he's going to be here for the Kiddush. And he's going to meet Brian Schreiber, and I understand the Holocaust Center also wants to meet him and talk to him. So I guess the Lord paid for all the joys he gave me with beautiful children. And you should be careful. Miriam and Bruce, Dr. Bruce Cohen, they have six grandchildren. By the way, that's what I wanted to tell you before. After seeing so much death at the age of 7, when Itzik was born, I was 11, and then Miriam was born, I was 16. It was like a revelation to me. For the first time, I realized that there is life after all I went through.
I didn't hear if you mentioned how your father died and when your mother remarried.
Yeah. About 3 days after liberation, my father and his brother, against my mother's wishes, went out to look for not a chicken, something to bring home and cook. You could get anything you wanted from the Germans, but it was a duck. And sure enough, he was sick already. He came home, she took him right to the hospital. Within 2-3 days, he died of typhoid. The funny thing was, my grandfather, who was 25 years older, also got typhoid, but he survived. He survived. Now, one might ask a question, like Rabbi Birkin asked me, Judah, how come you don't talk about your father so much? And I said, my father was on the bus, but my mother was the bus driver. You know, by the way, when I talked to kids, and I spoke to Shadyside Academy, and there were a couple of girls giggling, and I talked about my mother, and I told them, remember, there's only one person in your life who will lay her life down for you. Nobody else, except your mother. I got letters from all of them. One of the letters I received from a girl, she asked, I had issues with my mother. But today, when I got home, I looked for my mother, I found her, I grabbed her, I hugged her, I kissed her, and I told her how much I loved her. That's the benefit I get from my conversation. The fact that they treat me like a rock star. I don't like it.
Okay, for time's sake, we have time for just one more question. I think I saw a hand over here.
Yeah.
But
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes.
After liberation, what was the process for getting your life back together?
And the question was, after liberation, what was the process for getting your life back together?
I'm here in the middle of America.
Well, they did it in the stages. First, they took us to Paris to the Grand Hotel, which was a very, very fancy hotel. Very fancy hotel. And we were there for a couple of weeks. I remember it because first time I ever saw an elevator. And there was a whole room and there were benches. And my little friend was still with me. We always hid under the bench until the guy figured out we were down there and he kicked us out. Now, after a few weeks there, they took us to Orly. Orly today is the major airport near Paris. But at the time, there was a pension there, and then they fed us up. They fed us almost like ducks, the best of everything, till we rebuilt our power, our energy. And from there, we went to Marseille. By the way, in Paris, the Hungarian government sent emissaries, and so did the Soviet Union, looking for people who ran factories, because they didn't know how to do anything. So they asked my mother, would you come back? And she asked them, who's going to own the factory?
Well, the people, we are communists.
And my mother said, bye. And she did make a statement that no more genocide. Remember, we had tickets to come to America, and we went to Israel. By the way, my older brother Moshe has 4 boys, 15 grandchildren. His first boy is a psychologist. Second one is a vascular surgeon who works also with Vassar Hospital. He works also on the transplantation team. The third one is an entrepreneur. He's going to make everybody rich. He invented something that it's on very close to the end step towards it. And the young one has to do with, I don't know if it's not exactly the word right. He comes here a lot. I don't know if he comes here to recruit children or to recruit donors. I have a feeling that it's donors, but I'm not sure. My cousin question.
I have a brief question. Judah, I've known you for over 50 years. You were married to my cousin.
Right.
My father was your wife's uncle.
Right.
You made mention about your father's yeshiva roommate,
yeah,
which happened to be my father.
Right.
My question to you is, when did you discover that? And weren't you quite amazed that in the whole wide world, you ended up in Pittsburgh and there was your father's yeshiva roommate?
Well, your father and I became very, very good friends. And he started telling me about my father, things I had never heard before. Because he was a roommate for about 5-6 years at the yeshiva.
So he's the one who figured out.
He's the one who told me everything. He knew more about my family than I did. And what happened is that the Schiffman family and the Summit family, or the Marmorstein family, came from the same area in Hungary. So they just knew each other, but we were very, very close, your father and I, and then now very close with you and your brother there, sitting up there. Carl Schiffman is a very successful attorney.
Thanks for the plug.
I gotta say that Carl Schiffman has 4 children, 2 boys and 2 girls. Carl is an attorney. His wife is an attorney. 2 of his 4 are attorneys. No, 3. 3 are attorneys. And 1 is a surgeon. He's a baby surgeon.
Okay, everyone. For time's sake here, we're going to end this. But if you would like to come up and ask Judah any other questions or meet Judah, I'm sure he would be happy with that, or Miriam as well. And I want to thank everyone for coming, and thank you, Judah and Miriam.